Sr. Presidente, licença. Com a autorização do Presidente da Academia de Marinha, Almirante Francisco Vidal Abreu, declara-se aberta a sessão cultural conjunta de apresentação do livro Uma Relação entre Portugal e a Turquia em torno de Piri Reis. Vai usar a palavra o Presidente da Academia de Marinha.
Muito boa tarde a todos, excepcionalmente, e em honra aos nossos convidados, as minhas palavras vão ser em inglês. Isto já era suposto ser uma reunião internacional, mas fiquei a saber há bocadinho que, além da delegação turca, vamos ter cá duas pessoas de Espanha. Onde é que estão? Eles são mais de Portugal porque são da Galiza. E um francês também. Bem-vindos. Dear fellows, invited guests, just over 2 years ago, exactly on December 13th, 2016, a memorable joint section of an entire day involving Sociedade de Geografia de Lisboa, the Academia de Marinha, and the Turkish Embassy in Portugal took place. At the time, I made it very clear that the initiative of that meeting had been from the embassy, which deserves to be highlighted again. The subject that united these three entities was Admiral Piri Reis, an unavoidable military personality of the Ottoman Empire and also a notable cartographer. This dimension of his life was one of the essential aspects that made these three institutions join together through several of their reputed researchers. The session was so rich that it was decided, irrespective of the publication of the texts made available by the speakers, and that would be included in the 2016 memoirs of this academy, as it happened, such documentary collection was worthy of an autonomous publication in Portuguese and English, so that a greater number of researchers and curious of this unique person could benefit from the works then presented. The book was slow to get ready because translations were not always easy to obtain. But the upcoming ambassador's change also recommended an additional postponement, so that the new Turkish ambassador to Portugal, Mrs. Leyl Ulker, could already be present at this event. It is exactly in this condition that I greet you, Madam, as well as the remaining embassy delegation made up of my friend Admiral Metin Das, First Consular Mrs. Zeynep Galeli, and Defense Attaché Captain Nejat Gira. I hope it's very close. The book will be presented by Captain Malhão Pereira, which has been a continuous and excellent link between our two countries in the field of investigation of subjects related to nautical matters and naturally centered in Piri Reis. It is not by chance that the book is entitled A Relationship Between Portugal and Turkey Around Piri Reis. Before giving the floor to the following speakers, I would like to state formally the availability of this Academy to maintain the scientific cooperation between our two countries, in particular with the International Association of Maritime Studies of Turkey, of which Admiral Metin Atas was one of the founders, and Maritime History Practice and Research Center, of which the Admiral remains an important key driver. Thank you.
Vai usar da palavra o Presidente da Sociedade de Geografia de Lisboa, Professor Luís Aires de Barros.
Mrs. Ambassador of Turkish, Madam, Senhor Presidente da Academia de Marinha, Senhor Almirante Vidal de Abreu, prezados consócios da Academia Militar, peço desculpa, da Academia de Marinha. Minhas senhoras e meus senhores, at 13 December 2016, we had in Lisbon a scientific and cultural meeting involving the Turkish embassy in Portugal, the Academy of Marine and Geographical Society of Lisbon. In that meeting, it was evoked the Turkish Admiral Piri Reis, his activity not only as military, but also as a cartographer. These aspects have been emphasized by the participants in this meeting. The interest of the papers presented and discussed in that meeting, the Academy of Marine, with the collaboration of the Turkish Embassy and the Geographical Society of Lisbon, prepared a book including them. The presentation of this book is the motif of a new meeting among us. It's important, it's an important decision, and the occasion of the strengthening of Turkish-Portuguese relationships. For me, as president of the Geographical Society of Lisbon, it's a great pleasure and honor to participate in this very kind and important meeting. It's also a pleasure to meet again the Admiral Metin Ataş and also other members of the staff of the embassy. On behalf of the Geographical Society of Lisbon, my kind compliments to Mrs. Ambassador of Turkey. Madam, my compliments. Thank you.
Dar-se início à apresentação da obra Uma relação entre Portugal e a Turquia em torno de Piri Reis, pelo académico José Manuel Malhão Pereira.
Senhor Presidente da Academia de Marinha, Senhora Embaixadora da Turquia, Senhor Presidente da Sociedade de Geografia, Senhor Almirante Metin Ataş, I hope that you can hear me, I don't know. Professor Dejan Irkut, that came so far away to be here today. Senhores oficiais generais, membros da Academia de Marinha, minhas senhoras e meus senhores. First of all, I am very grateful to Admiral Vidalabreu for having suggested my name, to be here today, presenting the proceedings of our recent meeting. I cannot fail to express how honored I am. I intend, before a brief commentary on each of the papers presented, to give an historical summary of the events leading up to this meeting, drawing the attention to the fact that the intention of the Turkish institutions to contact the Portuguese Academy comes from afar. In fact, in 2010, the Turkish Naval Authorities made an attempt to hold an international conference consisting of a two-day meeting with various players of different nationalities, jointly organized by the Academia de Marinha, Universidade Nova de Lisboa, Centro de História de Alemar, and the École Pratique des Hautes Études de Paris, through Professor Dejan Irkut. Its theme was a shared history Turks and Portuguese in the Mediterranean, the Red Sea, and the Indian Ocean. Due to factors of various order, the above planned event did not materialize. Meanwhile, in 2010, Piri Reis Maritime University, founded in 2008 during the mandate of the then Chief of Naval Operations of the Turkish Navy, Admiral Metin Ataç, decided to organize a Maritime History Congress every other 2 years. The first International Congress of Maritime History, Turkish Maritime History, was held in Istanbul in 2012. And Professor Dejaneira Cote and myself, among dozens of academic students, participated. The aforementioned proceedings were duly edited and published. We have here one volume. There is one volume here of the that is the one in the center, which is the proceedings of that meeting. At the same event in Istanbul, the International Association of Maritime Studies was created and was based at Piri Reis University with 20 founding members. Its objects are, among others, to promote contact between researchers of maritime studies and their history, and to promote activities and events related to the same studies. In September 2013, the Maritime University Research and Practice Center was founded. Its objectives are, among others, to promote contact between researchers of maritime studies and their history, and to promote activities and events related to these same studies. In September 2013, the Maritime University Research and Practice Center was founded by the same university, being also coordinated by Admiral Metin Ataç. In 2014, the International Institute of Maritime Studies in Activity, a second congress, was held in St. Petersburg. Those are the founders of the IMS, and this is a photography of the event in 2014. In 2014, the International Institute of Maritime Studies in Activity, the same congress, was held in St. Petersburg. In this last congress, Professor Dejaneira Cote, Professor Rui Loureiro, and myself participated. A number of other congresses were held in different countries, and finally, in 2018, the joint cultural session was held in Portugal. This is the reason of our meeting today. Let us now make a brief commentary on the works presented. 7 personalities participated in the meetings of the Geographical Society and the Academia de Marinha. Following the edited proceedings, the first paper presented in this volume is by Dr. Paula Flar, currently Deputy Secretary of the History Section of the Naval Academy. Paula Flar acknowledges the importance of the travel prescriptions published in the early 16th century in Europe, motivated by the avalanche of new arrivals as a consequence of the Portuguese and Spanish explorations, considers that they were one of the sources of Piri Reis, not only for his maps of fragments of maps of 1513 and 1528, as well as for his Mediterranean script, the Kitab Ibahri. De Kitab Ibahri, ou seja, o livro, o roteiro está ali do lado esquerdo. É aquele exemplar que está ali. Is the one on the left side. Paula Velar essentially refers to the Paese novamente ritrovati per la navigazione di Spagna in Calicut e d'Albertuccio Vespuccio Fiorentino, intitulado Mondo Nuevo, novamente impresso, Francazano Montalbudo. whose first edition was published in Venice in 1507, and the Della Navigazione Viaja by Giovanni Battista Ramuzio, whose first edition was published in Venice in 1550. She also mentions that many of the published documents circulated already as manuscripts and were therefore accessible. There is also a strong influence on the way in which the Isolares text, and I quote, text that circulated in the Mediterranean from the beginning of the 15th century until the end of the 17th century appeared as a cosmographic encyclopedia of the islands, end of quote. In fact, these documents were, according to David Woodward, a collection of information about the islands and, I quote, each island usually having its own map and associated text. Some isolae also contain world or regional maps showing the location of islands relative to each other and to the adjacent mainland, end of quote. Ana Paula Avelar also believes that, and I quote, it is important to emphasize that in the 16th century, the alliance between narrative and drawing is recurrent when the spaces are represented, and how similar is the strategy of Francisco Rodrigues to that of Pere Reis, end of quote. There are countless graphic examples. I find it useful to draw attention to the fact that we often do not realize the wealth of information contained in compilations referred to above, and that they would have been the main sources of Pere Reis. See an excerpt of the index of one of the volumes. I'm not going to read, but all this is only 2 pages of the document, and the index of the 2 pages, and see then the highlighted in red informations which are related to the Portuguese history. I find it too full to draw attention to the fact that we often do not realize. See an excerpt of the index of one of the volumes of Pere of the Della Navigazione e Viaggio di Ramuzio. So this is the information related to the Ramuzio book, where I highlighted the subjects. It should be noted that the other document, the Paese Renovamento Retrovati of Montalbodo, have in about 260 pages vast information about the Portuguese maritime explorations. See also the similarity of styles of the islands images in the Liber Isolarum by Cristóvão Bon del Monte. I added an image of the Codex of Valentim Fernandes from 1507, which is also quite eloquent. É interessante verificar que esta imagem do que é de cerca de 30 anos antes é muito semelhante àquela, se isto é do livro de Valentim Fernandes, que é do século XV ainda. Paulo Avelar concludes by saying that the, and I quote, the knowledge of the world Pere Reis transmitted, reconfigured what would already be the considerable set of sources flowing in Europe, showing how in Ottoman circles the understanding of the world had changed, widening its borders, end of quotation. The other paper was by, which is in the order, I am speaking in the order, the documents come in the proceedings, Professor Mehmet Nekati Kutlu, the following speaker, is a translator for the Turkish of the Spanish and Portuguese languages, which makes it me think why I am speaking or trying to speak in English. In fact, Spanish with more than 400 million speakers and Portuguese with around 280 million will probably together be the most spoken languages in the world after the Mandarin. It should be noted that Spanish and Portuguese speakers understand each other in a written language. And he said that he is a French citizen. I think that he will not like very much to hear this. In the final part of this brief exposition, I will recall this subject. Our lecturer gives a well-founded summary of the life of Piri Reis. Let us point out some of the episodes. Point out some of the episodes that will have importance in his future life and in his scientific work, namely the participation with his uncle, Admiral Kemal Reis, in maritime expeditions of aid to the Muslims of the Iberian Peninsula in 1487, to the transfer of the Jews expelled from Castile and Lyon to participate in the campaign of 1500 against Venice, where he was assigned the command of a ship, the death of his uncle and the consequent retirement of our future admiral to this homeland, Gallipoli, where he remained for some years and where was produced his first world map. Having Piri Reis played an important role in the conquest of Alexandria and having returned from Egypt, he retired to his hometown where he wrote the Kitab al-Bahri. He then narrates his adventures with the Portuguese forces in the Indian Ocean, the difficulties encountered in an environment where the Ottoman naval forces had difficulties, not only in military and logistics, but also the successes and finally the failures of the admiral, which led to his trial and execution in Egypt in 1533. Mehmet Nekati Kutlu ends with a study of Piri Reis' scientific work after discussing the reasons that led to the execution of such an important individuality. Captain of Gaspar Windfast, in the last years, has devoted himself to the study of cartography, essentially in its technical aspects, intended in its communication, and I quote, to situate the map of Piri Reis in the context of the 16th century European cartography from which the geographical information was compiled, end of quotation. According to Piri Reis' own words, in fact, Piri Reis said the geographical information he got was from the European cartography. I'd like to quote what I had the opportunity to say in 2005. In a communication presented at Macau Scientific and Cultural Center, whose title is The Evolution of Nautical Science and Its Contribution to Contact Among Peoples, and I quote. It is also important to remember that sailors, and I was commenting about the character of a sailor, of a practical man of the sea. It is also important to remember that sailors use only the most appropriate and simple techniques to help them solve their navigational problems. To allow them to reach a previously known destination port and later on to return to it, we should never expect that those responsible for the navigation of a ship would employ complicated or erudite systems if the ones in use fulfill their needs. There are historians who wrongly bestow on the ancient mariners hypothetical scientific skills when these skills are totally unnecessary to successfully navigate in their areas. Excuse me, I have to take a piece of water. A These considerations are related to the fact that when studying Portuguese nautical cartography, important historians of this area are sustained that the nautical chart used by the Portuguese sailors in their Atlantic expeditions first and in the other oceans a little later was constructed according to some type of projection. However, António Barbosa, during the first Congress on the History of Portuguese Expansion in the World, 1938, states, and I quote, "It has been said and written that our cartographers and pilots of the 15th and 16th centuries replaced the cartographic system of medieval Portolans with the projection of Marino de Tiro, or flat rectangular chart, which then took the form of a square chart. He then accentuated and openly criticized Luciano Pereira da Silva, and I quote, "We have already shown that this doctrine is totally false." End of quote. It should be noted that Ventura da Costa, in his Marinharia dos Descobrimentos, which is from 1932, had the same opinion as Luciano da Silva. António Barbosa also says, "All the navigation of the 15th century from the first voyages of the pilots of Herod Navigator gave two distinct patterns of navigational charts, the standard of dead reckoning of navigation and the standard of latitude navigation. We can call them the patterns of the time of discovery. From the foregoing, it is concluded that the sea charts of the 14th century, 15th and 16th centuries have their own characteristics which do not exist in the other cartographic species." Currently, Aos Gaspar has dedicated much of his academic activity to deepening the geometry of the charts of the expansion period, throwing a new look on this important subject. It is on the basis of these studies that the author, following António Barbosa in the principles, uses methods of chart analysis, the results of which were compared with those of other contemporary charts. On this text, and on his text, it will suffice to inform you, the reader, that the study that the author presents to us is an attempt to correct many of the ideas that are frequently repeated about this important piece of cartography. Portanto, I think that's necessary really to make some review of what has been said about the Piriarés map and so on. Rui Loureiro, who has an in-depth knowledge of the history of Portuguese expansion in the East, presents us with an extensive and dense study of the sources of Iberian origin in geographical and cartographic works of Piriarés. He considers, referring to the map of 1513, that, and I quote, "its surprising modernity is explained above all by the use of sources of Iberian origin, resulting from almost a century of exploitation of the Atlantic on both of the banks," end of quotation. However, although less known or less studied, the Kitab Ibahri, um exemplar deles é aquele que está ali à esquerda, do vosso lado, which was prepared in 1520s, gathers precious geographical and cartographic information about the Mediterranean and also about many other geographic areas. End of quotation. In the preface of the Kitab Ibahri, Piriarés denotes to be specially well informed about the Portuguese explorations carried out along the coast of Africa and the Eastern Seas after the voyage of Bartolomeu Dias and Vasco da Gama. Rui Loureiro asks whether it will be possible to identify the Portuguese textual and cartographic sources of Portuguese origin that would have served Piriarés in the elaboration of his works. It is this identification of the sources that the author exposes. Crossing the history of Portuguese navigations and maritime expansion with the unexpectedly well-grounded descriptions of Ferrez in his words. This cross-check with the information of the Ottoman Admiral is a powerful indication of the way information circulated through various agents, especially Italians, which leads us to think of the difficulties that the Portuguese Crown had in pursuing the much studied and controversial policy of secrecy. But the author, having at his disposal the relatively recent transcription of the preface of the Kitab Bahri by Jean-Louis Bacchi Ramon, has also studied it deeply. In a passage from his extensive discussion of this diversified introduction, this introduction of Pirérez in his second edition of the Kitab Bahri was in verse, which Pirérez included on the edition of his book, that has been offered to Suleiman the Magnificent in 1526, Rui Loureiro, commenting on Pirérez's description of India Run, Portuguese Carreira da Índia, states that, and I quote, reading the description of the Turkish text, it will be possible, through the technical indications provided, to roughly delineate the route of the Portuguese navigations in a chart representing the Atlantic, Africa, and India, end of quote. He further states that, and I quote once again, sources of an ambiguous Portuguese origin have been used here, end of quote. I consider very useful to follow this suggestion of Rui Loureiro. So I am now studying a nautical interpretation of this part of the versified introduction. And I think that's very interesting to recognize that Pirérez, in the second decade of the 16th century, was already so well informed about our Carreira India and so on. It was really that book, which is a very good edition, is very useful for us. Edno Metina Tats, who after a brilliant naval career, considered that he could continue to be useful to his great nation, the main responsible for all us being here today, exchanging ideas about our common history. I am saying that he is the main responsible. His paper essentially summarizes the personnel and institutional life of Pirérez and his scientific work. Initially describes the discovery in 1929 of the fragment of Pirérez's map of 1513 made by the director of the then converted to museum Topkapi Palace. Pirérez states in an annotation with his map that Columbus is his main source for the design of the coasts of the and islands of the West. The discovery was made public in Leiden by a German academic, Paul Kahler. This action was followed by the announcement of 1528 fragment, and finally his Kitab Bahri, which began to be compiled in 1381 and which was made public only 45 years later. Our Admiral also emphasized the important role played by Kemal Reis, Pirérez's uncle, in his naval military training and in deepening of his nautical knowledge, since they carried out numerous operations together during most of his life. Kemal Reis dies as a result of a storm in 1511. A comprehensive summary of the historiography of Pirérez's naval and scientific life is also made, and a vast bibliography is provided, which is an excellent reference for the future and also a testimony of the interest shown by historians to the outstanding personality of Pirérez and his scientific legacy. Professor Dejanira Couto is a profound expert on Ottoman and Indian Ocean history, including the relations of the Portuguese with the Islamic powers of the Persian Gulf. This work, her work, complements another published in 2011, where she explores the Ottoman documentation published by Genghis Ornoglu, and where again the modernized transcriptions of the old documents by Jean-Louis Bacquier-Ramon were very useful. I think that this is necessary for us, Bacquier-Ramon. The professor presents a profound, extensive, and very well documented text in which, crossing mainly Turkish and Portuguese sources, develops the theme of the tragic end of Piri Reis. The main accusations to which Piri Reis was subjected, notably that of treason, have mainly been presented as a result of the events that followed the attempt to conquer Hormuz, since the fleet used for operations in the Indian Ocean had been abandoned in Basra. With three galleys, one of which was shipwrecked, we returned to Suez. The image shows the relative geographical positions of the referred places. This is only to show you the Indian Ocean, the northern part, and the positions of Basra, of Aden, and so on. Political intrigue at the level of the administrative domains of Suez, Basra, and also Portuguese ones in Hormuz and Muscat are also discussed. In analyzing these issues, the author shows us the intricate commercial structure, the interests at stake, which involved not only the Turks and the Portuguese, but also the other political entities in the area. I transcribe below the interesting passage of her work, which is an elucidative document of the pragmatism with which live the diverse commercial and political protagonists in the area, and also the permanent conflict between those who work in the theater of operations and those who judge their actions at a long distance. She comments that Piri Reis was accused of, during the siege of Hormuz, allowing the plundering of the properties of the Muslim merchants who lived in or frequented Hormuz. Dejan Irakot says, "This unforgivable attitude for those who were far from the theater of operations and unaware of the logistical difficulties with which Piri Reis had debated would strongly compromise the Ottomans' prestige of the Arab Persian population and the commercial links between the two great Gulf cities built since 1546, with so many difficulties by the Portuguese, Ottomans, and Persians, despite political military disputes and religious differences." End of quote. Let me highlight that this and other facts of the history of nations were analyzed by politicians normally comfortably installed and far away from the theater of operations. The Jair quote ends by asking, and I quote, "Will this climate of local and regional conflict weigh heavily on the Sultan's decision to punish the imminent cartographer so harshly, as you know, he has been decapitated?" I frankly think so, that the reason was like she says. Let us finally see the work of this humble sailor. In 2000 in Goa, and in an Indo-Portuguese history seminar, I presented a communication in which I emphasized the need to know very well the physical conditions of the oceans and seas when studying the maritime expansion. In that particular case, and as the world trade greatly expanded for or become globalized after the Iberian voyages over the 15th and 16th centuries, the problem of the navigability of the Red Sea and its consequences were studied. But before continuing, I must accentuate that I have always been interested in sailing, and from an early age, I have become familiar with reading travel descriptions of long distance voyages and devouring articles from sailing magazines or books. And one of the sections of these journeys was the return from the Indian Ocean to Europe through the Red Sea. All the authors spoke of the last 600 miles of the north half of this area. And in this image, you can see that I'm trying to represent that in that. You see, this people is sailing, and this people is rowing. And this is 600 miles to Sweden. And from here to the, it's, this is the reason why Jeddah was organized. But if you read the paper, you will understand. All the authors spoke about those 600 miles. In Aix-en-Provence, in another seminar of Indo-Portuguese history, I presented another work with a similar theme, but adapted to the circumstances. And in Lisbon, at the Academia de Marinha, I presented the one that I am commenting now. And this image is also one that I'm not going to explain, but is related to this subject. I will not dwell on more considerations related to this work. I only ask historians to pay attention to it and to consider the conditions in which men and ships moved in ports, in commercial networks, in naval confrontations, and so on. Now I am going to conclude. As a researcher on the history of nautical and Portuguese expansion, and as a member of Academia de Marinha and other related institutions, I intend to conclude this brief communication, if I may, with some suggestions for the future. One of them is related to the nautical science of the Indian Ocean and the Portuguese nautical science originated in the Atlantic. I am specifically referring to the exchange of information between the navigators of the Indian Ocean and Southeast Asia with Europeans, and the evolution of his methods and instruments for at least half a century. And one of the testimonies is the Muhit of Turkish Admiral Sidi Ali Reis, personality close linked to Admiral Pire Reis. He has the admiral which was in charge of bringing the galleys that Pire Reis had left. And the voyage he couldn't make the voyage, and so he stayed in India for 1 year and then time to make a good book. One is the Muhit. I addressed this issue at the Istanbul meeting in 2012. Our Society of Geography, during the 450th anniversary of Vasco da Gama's trip in the 19th century, had a wide participation on this subject, producing several scientific works, such as that of Dr. Júlio Gonçalves, Professor William Tomaszek, member of the Australian Academy of Science, Gabriel Ferran, Luciano Pereira da Silva, and so on. Sometimes we forget that some 100 years ago almost, we were not forgetting Vasco da Gama and his voyage. However, the document in question was only transcribed and partially translated, and an overall assessment of the document was not possible. This would be very useful for the history of the Indian Ocean and for nautical science. And this page is from Tomaszek, the professor that studied the charts of Sidi Ali Reis in the Muhit and compared them with Portuguese and so on. May I suggest that if the Kitab-i Bahri has been transcribed and translated into Spanish, and I'm referring to that book there, and studied in Spain, why not transcribe the entire Muhit and translate it into English? Or why not in Spanish and study in Portugal? I dare to suggest the most appropriate personality to do, both the transcription and the translation. I am referring to Professor Mehmet Nekati Kutlu, who is the gentleman that has a degree on Spanish and was involved with us. I believe that the history of Portuguese maritime expansion and the history of the Turkish continental and maritime expansions are closely linked. In fact, during the 16th century, the Portuguese in the Indian Ocean only had, as European political and military opponents, the Ottoman Empire, which was European, Mediterranean, and Asian. And I'm referring to the 16th century, because Dutch, English, and French only from the 17th century on arrived in the area. Moreover, the Ottomans were not only opponents, but also allies. In fact, after the taking of Ormuz by the Persians in 1622, and before the ascending of Persian influence in the region, the Turks of Bassora and the Portuguese Muscat were united, and the good relations then established even led to that in 14 April of 1625 was inaugurated in that Turkish city, Basra, a Catholic temple, the Church of Our Lady of Remedies. Only in 1717 this good relations cooled, and the reason was the Battle of Matapan, as you can know. So, for more than two centuries, there has been a common history that has not yet been properly studied. As said above, the Portuguese and Indian cultural institutions have been conducting seminars of Indo-Portuguese history for some decades, resulting in a vast collection of documents. And the Indian Navy has cooperated, having even asked the Navy Academy some years ago to collaborate in order to found a similar association. In these circumstances, I can only welcome the fact that this meeting had taken place. This was a very profitable event. However, we must ask them to plan our next meeting, because the void left by its non-fulfillment may be filled by our friends who are jumping the Great Wall. I don't know if you know who is the Gordon. And something like this, something similar to what this image shows may happen. I will end my words by presenting the excellent text that justified the plan, the 2010 meeting, and which I intend to propose for publication attached to this communication. And I was reading this, and this is what Dejane Jacot proposed in 2010 to make the event that did not happen. And I will not read the text, because otherwise, bye-bye Galatasaray. Thank you.